So in this video, we're going to talk about properties of liquids. I would recommend that you watch the video on intermolecular forces prior to watching this video if you're not up to speed on intermolecular forces. So let's start with a property of liquids called surface tension. And what I have here is water represented with some molecules of water expanded, just so you can see what's going on. And this is a molecule. Let's just focus on this one right here in the center. This is in the interior of the water. So it's surrounded by water on all sides. So by hydrogen bonding, it's bound in all directions equally. And then let's compare that to a molecule of water that's actually on the surface over on the right. And if I focus on that particular molecule, you'll see that it's surrounded on all sides except the top, because it's on the surface and there's only air above it. So if I was to focus on the one on the left, the force vectors from hydrogen bonding pulling on it are equally distributed in all directions, so the net force vector acting on it is zero. But if I go back over here to the right, the force vectors are acting in all directions except up. So if I do a force vector on that, it actually has a net force downward. So you would imagine that as you get out farther into the surface of this water, it would actually bend down. And that's in fact what we see if you look at most liquids when they're inside of a container. They have what we call a meniscus, which pulls down. And just a reminder, when you're reading like this, a graduated cylinder, you should read from the bottom of the meniscus. But this is surface tension. And going back, in essence, the surface tension is really the intermolecular force between the molecules on the surface. And it's strong enough in some cases to literally create a net on the surface of this water. And this is exhibited by this lizard they call the Jesus lizard, because it can walk on water. But basically, there's enough surface tension that the weight force of that lizard will not penetrate through the water, and it can literally run on water. Very cool. So comparing what would create surface tension, it's based on intermolecular force. And just taking very simple materials, if you took mercury liquid, for example, that's actually on the verge of metallic bonding. So we call that intramolecular force, but it's an order of magnitude above the rest. Mercury to mercury bonds are very strong. You work down to hydrogen bonding with water. And butanol, which has some hydrogen bonding, but it's also disturbed by weaker van der Waals forces. And then if you get the same sort of bonding in a little shorter chain length, ethanol. And then if you go down to diethyl ether, if anything, there's a dipole between the oxygen and carbon, gives a little bit of a surface tension. And you can imagine it go down even more if it was a nonpolar material. So now at this time, I'd like to show you a demonstration of surface tension. Okay, we're gonna do a little demonstration on surface tension. And what I've done is I've put a little deionized water in this beaker. And I'm just going to take this paper clip and see if I can't just gently place it on there. So if you take Dawn dish soap, which really is has strong attraction for water, but not as strong as water has for itself, then what you can do is you can break the surface tension. There'll actually be molecules of Dawn interdispersed between the water. And this happens fairly quickly. So what I'm going to do is just put a little bit on the edge, and you'll see it work its way down there. There you go. And it's going to hit the water, and it's going to disperse. And it'll actually dissolve enough, it'll break the surface tension. And there you go. So how do you measure surface tension? Well, one thing you can do is you can basically get a hydrophobic type material, Teflon or a plastic, and you can literally drop a little bit on the surface. And if you observe Those through a microscope or through a magnifying glass, you can see an angle that starts to show up between the surface and then the surface of the solvent. And if it has a high surface tension, i.e. it has a lot of intermolecular bonding, it will actually ball up more, and this angle will start to be very tight. And then as the surface tension starts to decrease, the ball gets less defined, and this opens up, and you basically, the contact angle becomes larger. So the next prop of liquids that I would like to talk about is capillary action. And so in capillary action, you once again have this, I have water as my example, it's sitting in a container. As we know, there's also intermolecular bonding, hydrogen bonding. That's what holds the water together. But capillary action is when the liquid starts to literally climb up the container. So this really is evident in small tubules. And so part of that is the hydrogen bonding holding the water together. But that doesn't necessarily explain the upward force. The forces that you need to understand for capillary action have to do with the container wall has molecules, and these molecules might have a sidewall attraction. For example, glass has silanol, silicon with oxygen bonds, which are slightly polar. And so it's possible for the water to actually attract to these. So here we have these bonding between the molecules and the sidewall. But once again, that doesn't necessarily explain an upward force unless you think about the interior molecules again. So here we look at an interior molecule of water, and it has the strongest attraction for the molecules in the sidewall that directly across from it. The molecules in the sidewall that are above and below it are pretty much taken up with the waters that are close to them. Same thing here, right? But when you get up to the top, there's a unique situation, and that is there's no water above to have an attraction for the sidewall molecules. So we can have a little extra force coming down from these sidewalls for those waters in this example. And if you think about these forces acting on that water, it would give a net force up, and that's what actually creates the lift. So really, when you think about capillary action, the big factors are the intermolecular force, but it's not so much the intermolecular force between the molecules in the solvent, it's more the intermolecular force of the solvent for the sidewalls. The other thing about capillary action that's important to understand, it's also dependent on how big the diameter of the opening is. And I'm going to try and explain that real quick. Basically, this is a top view of this cylinder, or maybe it's a little capillary tube or a little pipette tube, whichever. And so we're just talking about what's the diameter of the opening. Okay, so if I was really looking at the circumference along that opening, that is where on the capillary, right? That's where it makes attraction. The liquid makes attraction to the sidewall only along the circumference of this liquid. So if you do the math on that, that's 2 pi r. Well, the other factor of, you know, this particular column of fluid lifting is actually the weight that it's having to lift. So as this particular column of fluid starts to lift up, it literally is lifting all the weight of the fluid below it. So now the question might be, well, how does the weight change as that radius expands? So more volume increases the weight, which creates a downward force. And that's the same kind of principle. You know, it's still based on R, but this factor R is now squared, and now the entire surface is involved in the weight, not just the circumference. Look, this has a factor of R, because R times 2 pi gives you circumference. But when you think about surface area, it's actually R squared times pi times height, which would be the whole volume of the column it's trying to lift. So here I have that kind of image drawn right here. So long story short, this radius is actually a squared effect when it comes to the volume that it's trying to lift. This radius is a direct effect to the circumference of contact. So as the circumference grows, as the radius gets bigger, the contact area is increasing, but it's not increasing as rapidly as the total surface, which generates the weight. So now I'm going to do this little demonstration of capillary action. So this video, I want to give you a demonstration of capillary action, and I want to just demonstrate that one of the major factors in capillary action is actually just the diameter of the tube. So I'm going to use these two tubes. The one obviously has much bigger diameter than the other. See if I can let those sit there long enough for the camera to focus. All right, demonstration's very simple. Just get a little distilled water, put it in the beaker. Then we'll just give it a little coloring for effect to make the viewing a little easier, hopefully. Put a little white background here so it's easier to see. Let's just drop the capillary tubes in there and see how diameter has an effect on capillary action. So now those have had a little bit of a chance to climb. Let's get the camera down where you can see the results. Push them down so they're flat on the bottom. And I think this pretty much demonstrates that the smaller diameter definitely exhibits more capillary action. And that is a weight effect. So the last property is viscosity, which is the resistance to fluid flow. And basically, the first property of viscosity to understand is as things warm up, they become less viscous, they actually flow quicker. And this is shown right here in this chart, that is, you take a material, it's water, it has a viscosity at room temperature, so many newtons, seconds per square meter. Room temperature, it has a viscosity of 1 times 10 to the minus 3. You start to heat it up and the viscosity drops, which in essence translates to it's easier to pour, or things will flow through it quicker. So once again, the two factors here on viscosity are intermolecular force and temperature. And just as an example, I have a couple liquids pouring. One with a high viscosity, which is down here at the bottom, it pours slowly, and one with a low viscosity, which actually pours fairly quick. So how do you measure this stuff in the lab? One of the simple experiments is the falling ball, and I'll show you a demonstration of that here in a minute, and you'll actually do that in the lab. Along with how easily something pours, which is demonstrated over here, the other thing, factor to think about with viscosity is how quickly something can break through volume. And so here you just basically drop a ball and time it. And then the other viscosity measurement is done with these rotational commutators, which it takes a spinning fixture and it drops it into the liquid, so it measures the torque that's trying to slow down the spinning action when this drops into this container full of the liquid. And of course this has some this temperature control ports so that you can do this at a set temperature. So now I'm going to show you a little demonstration of viscosity. So I've got two liquids, Cairo syrup and water, and obviously the water is much less viscous. So viscosity has to do with how well fluids pour all over each other. And so this liquid, water, actually pours fairly good. The intermolecular forces, although they're strong, they're not as strong as the long hydrocarbon chain involved in syrup, which not only exhibits hydrogen bonding, but it also exhibits a lot of weak van der Waals, but it has many points of attraction. So consequently, when you go to pour Cairo syrup, it pours very slow. So I'm going to squeeze that to kind of speed up the process here. And we know we can change that by heating things up and their viscosity will increase. That's one way. But the demonstration I also want to show you is another way to get at viscosity is not how quickly they pour, but how quickly something can break through them is also a measure of viscosity. So my experiment's very simple. I'm just going to take a couple marbles, basically equivalent, same mass, same size, and we're going to just drop them through the two solutions and see which one travels quicker. And of course the one that travels fastest is the least viscous liquid. So here we go, 1, 2, 3, drop. And water's already at the bottom. And here comes the Cairo syrup. And you literally can do calculations of distance versus time to figure out the viscosity of the liquid. So I hope these demonstrations and this discussion has helped you understand the properties of liquids.